Good morning, everyone, and welcome to worship here at Port Elgin United Church. It's the seventh Sunday of Pentecost. We're getting there out of 26. We'll get there soon, maybe. It's July 17, 2022, and I'm Reverend John Smith. Great to be here with you today. And let's have a hand for Paul and Dorothy McClaren, Nancy Kline, and our worship team. Great to have you here with us. If you are looking for something to do tonight, our other musician, Jenny Robinson, is putting on a concert up at, sorry, I'm losing my breath today, up at the Southampton Bandshell, 7 o'clock tonight. She and her husband and their band, a variety of music. You're all welcome to take your lawn chairs and take part. What was that?
Fairy Lake.
Fairy Lake. You can tell I'm not from this area, right? To me, it's a big pond. Now, over the summer, we are learning about some of Jesus' parables. We're working to enlarge our understanding of them, but also hoping to appreciate the wisdom master that Jesus really was, and to incorporate some of that teaching into our daily lives. Today, we're going to be talking about the parable of the lost coin. We're also learning new spiritual practices, and I've been handing out a pamphlet each week. There is a pamphlet today for you to pick up on your way out. And I was going to say to our online visitors, if you want any of these materials, just send us an email. We'll send it to you quite happily. Well, let's begin. May the light of Christ fill us, hold us, keep us, enlarge us, and give us peace. Amen. Our call to worship. This is the day that God has made.
Let us rejoice and be glad.
This is the day that God has made for us.
We are grateful to be our God.
This is the day I will begin again, fresh and new as the sunrise this morning. This is the day I will surrender and place myself totally in God's hands.
This is the day that I will open my spirit to worship and praise and joy.
On this day, let us declare that the gates of joy are open wide.
Let us declare that the path led us where we need to go.
Let us declare that our journey today will have meaning and blessing. And so, on this glorious day that God has allowed us to see, let us be divinely determined and dutifully dedicated to live the life God has created us to live. Amen. Amen. May it be so. Amen. So we're going to sing an old hymn, part of the family, and I don't know about you, but it was one that I was raised on. When I hear this hymn, I think of my Sunday school classes, just like some of those hymns that they were singing before church. I think of the songs that I was raised on. So this is come in and sit down.
Thank you.
So after the spoken prayer, there will be a moment of quiet for your own prayer, and then what I call the community prayer, which we'll say together, and then our hymn, which is one probably not well known. We're going to stay seated for the hymn. So spoken prayer, quiet prayer, community prayer, hymn. That's the order. Let us pray. If I choose, O God, I can follow the path you have set before me. If I choose to relinquish control, to let go the need to be always right, and to set my worries and fears down by the side of the road, I know that I can follow you. Your love leads me in this path of wisdom. Your love will never leave me to live my life alone. As we come to worship today, let our hearts and minds center on Christ, who guides us on the path, and whose Spirit holds our whole lives with compassion and love. We thank you, God, that you desire only goodness for us, and that you are creating a path toward goodness each moment of every day. Such grace is too wonderful for words. Let us trust in the presence of God's love wherever our path takes us, and find God's presence in every single soul we encounter today. May we be attentive to the soul's journey today and find abundant grace in every step. And now our community prayer. As I live every day, I want to be a channel for peace. May I bring love where there is hatred and healing where there is hurt, joy where there is sadness and hope where there is fear. I pray that I may always try to understand and comfort other people, as well as seeking comfort and understanding from them. Wherever possible, may I choose to be a light in the darkness, a help in times of need, and a caring, honest friend. And may justice, kindness, and peace flow from my heart forever. Amen.
Still with you, your knees are
Yesterday, on the lake, not a ripple. Sitting beside the lake, where no waves are rolling in, watching the birds fly out around and come back, a scene of utter peace and serenity. And so, in our prayer, that's what we look for. We're looking for peace and serenity on the inside. We're looking to find that place where the Spirit speaks our name. As that hymn said, God spoke our name before we were born. And then we live with that inside of us, this place where the Holy Spirit stirs us, but also brings us back to calm and quiet, peace and serenity. And so that's the practice for this week. If you pick up my pamphlet on your way out today, it's called Centering Prayer. What does centering prayer mean? It means finding the center of your being. It means finding God there, right? God in the center of your being. And so the practice is literally a practice because, trust me, it takes a lot of practice to find the center of your being. But I'm going to show you how to do it. You just sit in a regular chair, nothing fancy, none of those fancy cross-legged moves or anything like that, like you might do at yoga. Just nice and calm. If you are thinking that you might do it for a while, you might set the timer on your stove for 10 minutes or something. You get settled, close your eyes, and you think of the word that is important to you that might bring you back to center. So for me, what I say is, here I am, right? Here I am. I'm telling God, I'm here, I'm ready, I'm present, that's all I'm doing. So I just close my eyes. I say to myself, here I am. And I let myself breathe. Now there's a problem. I'm gonna think things, right? My mind has what we call monkey brain. And monkey brain is like monkeys jumping through the trees. And you know how that is. As soon as you stop doing something for a little bit of time, your brain starts to get kind of active. Or when you wake up in the middle of the night and your brain is kind of going like that, that's called monkey brain. And how do you train monkey brain? It's hard to train a monkey. Here I am. I find that quiet place, and then the monkey tells me, oh, did you forget to pick up milk at the store yesterday? Here I am. Right? And eventually, the time that you can do that calmly and gently and quietly expands. Now, a lot of people will say prayer doesn't work. Right? It's usually because we don't get what we want. This kind of prayer has the effect of opening our hearts, right? It just opens up our being and it helps you live your life from a quiet, calm place. It's a beautiful thing. So I hope that you'll try it. Give it a week, see how it goes. Let me know if you'd like to learn more about it, and I could even have a class on it. We could learn how to do it together, because it's really fun to do with a group. So give it a practice and see how it goes. Also, those of you who are working on your spirals, I do want these back. I got one today. They are trickling in. I know that many of you picked them up. If you want to take one today, there's some on the back table. And what I want to know is, what are the gifts that you have, that you're bringing to the party, right? As we rebuild our church, as we come back together, as we think about the future that we're going to have, what are the gifts that you are bringing to the party? You just write them on here, wherever you want, and then in a couple of weeks, you'll see what we're gonna do with them, okay? So it's time to bring them back. Okay, so I think it's time for our scripture.
Good morning. Our first reading this morning is taken from Psalm 139, verses 1 to 14. You have searched me, Lord, and you know me. You know when I sit and when I rise. You perceive my thoughts from afar. You discern my going out and my lying down. You are familiar with all my ways. Before a word is on my tongue, you, Lord, know it completely. You hem me in behind and before, and you lay your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me, too lofty for me to attain. Where can I go from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence? If I go up to the heavens, you are there. If I make my bed in the depths, you are there. If I rise on the wings of the dawn, if I settle on the far side of the sea, even there your hand will guide me. Your right hand will hold me fast. If I say, surely the darkness will hide me, and the light become night around me, even the darkness will not be dark to you. The night will shine like the day, for darkness is as light to you. For you created my inmost being. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you because I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Your works are wonderful. I know that full well. Our second reading is taken from Luke, chapter 15, verses 1 to 10. Now the tax collectors and sinners were all gathering around to hear Jesus. But the Pharisees and the teachers of the law muttered, "This man welcomes sinners and eats with them." Then Jesus told them this parable. Suppose one of you has 100 sheep and loses one of them. Doesn't he leave the 99 in the open country and go after the lost sheep until he finds it? And when he finds it, he joyfully puts it on his shoulders and goes home. Then he calls his friends and neighbors together and says, "Rejoice with me, I have found my lost sheep." I tell you that in the same way, there will be many more rejoicing in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous persons who do not need to repent. Or suppose a woman has 10 silver coins and loses one. Doesn't she light a lamp, sweep the house, and search carefully until she finds it? And when she finds it, she calls her friends and neighbors together and says, "Rejoice with me, I have found my last coin." In the same way, I tell you, there is rejoicing in the presence of the angels of God over one sinner who repents. This is the word of the Lord.
I can see it here.
Thank you very much. That was just beautiful. Well, I've had a bad cold all week, as you can probably tell, and it's just hard to get my breath going here today, but I'll try my best anyway. Years ago, Anne Tyler wrote a beautiful novel called The Accidental Tourist, in which the protagonist, a Macon Leary, traveled all over the world to cities like London and Paris and Berlin and Prague, for example, with a view to writing travel advice for business executives who might be going to those cities, but who did not want to experience the culture or the language or the food of a strange and foreign land. And so he would stay in the blandest hotels. He would search out the restaurants that served the blandest food, like apple pie and ice cream, let's say. Anything homey, nothing weird, nothing pretentious. He wanted to be able to get in, get out, as if you have never left home. Now, those of you who've traveled a little bit, you know how boring that would be, right? Predictability, blandness, conformity, these were the qualities most preferred by Macon Leary. Let's call this the default world, right? The world that you organize around your preferences, the world that you schedule for yourself, the routines that you develop in your own little life. And you know how it is sometimes. If you're staying at somebody's house, let's say, and their morning routines are very different from your morning routines, right? You can hardly wait to get home so you can get back to your morning routines. Now, in the New Testament, the teachings of Jesus invite us into the most unconforming, unpredictable, and colorful life one could imagine. And we're calling it parable world, right? We're calling Jesus' alternative vision of the world parable world, which is the world in direct contrast to our default world. Jesus called it the kingdom of heaven which is within you, which is what I discussed with you last week. The thing is, after 2,000 years, the kingdom of heaven within you is still the least understood aspect of the teaching of Jesus. And it's the one which seems to confound us still. And you can imagine somebody like Macon Leary, the protagonist of that book, Accidental Tourist, reading and thinking about the teachings of Jesus. He wouldn't be at all interested in the kingdom within, because it would upset his strictly ordered world. It would upset his defined worldview. And in general, it would challenge him to look at his own world with alternative lenses. Who wants that? I ask you. And that is why, in general, church people do not spend a lot of time trying to understand the kingdom of heaven as Jesus preached it. We want predictability. We want someone to tell us how it is. We want the T's crossed and the I's dotted for us. We don't want to have to think differently about the world, even our little worlds, let's say. And I don't think it's because we don't want to change. I think what it is we don't want to look under the carpet of our own anxiety and fear. Questioning things makes us anxious. And for sure, it means we're not completely in control of our lives anymore. And the one thing most of us do not want to give up is control. However, consider, if scientists did not question how the world works, or let's say how the universe works, they would not have sent that James Webb telescope out into the universe to show us those astounding pictures of what things look like far out in space. Those things those pictures are going to be described and written about for the next generation, throwing science perhaps into a tailspin as it tries to figure things out now with all of this new information. Scientists love that, right? That's what they live for. They live for this new information, new ways of understanding the world. By the same token, if we didn't question the stories of Jesus, how will we ever learn something new? How will we ever learn the eternal truths underneath of them? So thinking about parable world for a moment, we note that the characters are almost always nameless. He never gives them a name. They are anonymous characters. A man is out sowing seeds in a garden, he says. A woman is making bread with yeast. A farmer finds a treasure in a field. A master calls a servant in about a feast, etc. This is very deliberate. It forces the reader to abandon some of our habits, which is to define people the way we normally define them in our default world. So, for instance, we describe ourselves, generally speaking, based on outward identity. If you were to meet me for the first time, I might say to you, well, I'm a man, I'm a minister, I'm married, I have kids, I'm in my 60s, I make this much money, I'm not going to tell you how much. This is the standard way of defining ourselves in the default world. But these identifiers tell you absolutely nothing about me. And they do not matter in the parable world. Parables are about everyone. And in particular, they're about everyone who has an inkling that there's something more, right? And so they are anonymous characters because Jesus wants us to put ourselves into that situation. So Jesus basically forces us to abandon the default world and exposes its emptiness to us. And here then is one of the best things about understanding parable world, because when we can let go of our default world and stand back from it for a moment, we see that we are living with only one set of possibilities among a whole set of possibilities. And so the parable liberates us and shows us that there are infinite ways of being in the world. It would be, I think, like that accidental tourist going to Paris and trying out everything new and fresh and interesting, you know, having a coffee and croissant on the Champs-Élysées, is what I'm saying. His life would be different after that. So let me show you what I mean with the story of the lost coin. A woman loses a coin in her house. She cleans the house like a demon. She sweeps under everything in sight, and when she finds it, there is great joy. How awesome for her. The end. But that's not the end, is it? Right? It's not the end of the story. There are other possibilities here. For the woman who found the coin, something changes. Right? We're not talking about finding a loony under a carpet, are we? We're talking about finding something really significant for her life. She calls up her friends in order to share her joy at finding this lost thing. They come over, she has a party. Maybe she spends that coin and two or three more on the party that she has for her spontaneous party for her friends. You see, coins are not a measure of wealth, which is how we would want to interpret the story, because coming from our default world, we're all about worth and value and, you know, how much money do we have. We're from the default world where a penny saved is a penny earned, or Why would you waste so much money on your friends? In our world, we worry about retirement accounts or the train wreck that has been the stock market this year. You all know that. We know all about profit and loss, and it makes us very unhappy indeed. So just remember, happiness only comes from the outside. Joy only comes from the inside. Right? Joy comes from that quiet center we talked about. So the default person will say, "You silly woman, you were only down one coin before, but now you're down four." To which the woman might respond, "You silly man, you were at a party, a kingdom party, and you never experienced the joy." Jesus' parables, you see, are very disarming. Even this simple little parable upsets our worldview. You can't argue with them, with the fiercely held tenets of the default world. You have to immerse yourself in parable world first in order to hear what they are saying. Well, back in 2012, there was a historic meeting between two of our time's most spiritually authoritative characters, Archbishop Desmond Tutu from South Africa and the Dalai Lama. It was held in the home territory of the Dalai Lama in India, the purpose of which was to discuss and describe some of the key common teachings between Buddhism and Christianity. Now, at first glance, you might say, there's nothing at all for them to say to each other. I mean, Buddhism doesn't have a God, and Christianity, some people would say that Jesus was God. But it turns out that both of these major movements or religions in the world had an incredible wisdom teacher as their founder. And so, interestingly enough, at the end of this week-long meeting between these two spiritual greats, they wrote a book, and it was called The Book of Joy. And what they meant was, when the spiritual traditions of the world come together, there will be joy. Now, as I've been saying this summer, one of our key teachings is this idea of the kingdom of heaven within. And while we would describe it differently, the teaching is the same between Buddhists and Christians. Buddhists believe that the heart is like a cavern with four walls. And so there's this cavern on the inside of us with four walls. And the walls are held up by four pillars. And the pillars are love, joy, compassion, and equanimity. Now, I don't have time in a time-limited video tape service to talk about all four of those, but just to say that these four things are unlimited gifts, according to the Buddhists. They are called the immeasurables. And these four things, love, joy, compassion, and equanimity, are called immeasurables because they never run dry. Right? They never run out. Important. Right? That's hugely important for us in our world today. Right? To know that there is a place inside of us where love, joy, compassion, and equanimity never run out. So let's talk about joy for a moment. The woman who finds a lost coin, you see, is a symbol of this never-ending joy. She will share that joy with everyone she can because she has found not a coin, you see, but she has found that this unlimited gift lives inside of her, right? This unlimited gift of joy rests within her. And finding that is worth throwing a party for. Bishop Tutu said that joy is our essential nature. He said it's not just about having fun, but that joy leads us to be more empathic, more empowered, and more deeply engaged with the world around us. This is because it cannot be contained. When we access it, it pours out, right? When we tap into that source, it is like a fountain that starts spewing out of us. That's how joy operates. Now, before you think that this is all too simple, let me say to you, Tutu had not had an easy life. He was the one who led the anti-apartheid movement in South Africa while Nelson Mandela was incarcerated in prison for 27 years. In his later years, he got prostate cancer, almost died, recovered a few years later, got prostate cancer, almost died, and then continued to live a little bit longer, but was in intense pain for the last few years of his life. The Dalai Lama was forced to leave his native Tibet by the Chinese. He was marched through the highest mountains in the world before he was allowed to settle in India, and still he faces persecution and death threats wherever he travels in the world. He will never be able to go home. So each of these two figures have suffered intense suffering and persecution, and yet here they are, known around the world for, well, when you hear people talk about the Dalai Lama, what did they say about him? He laughs all the time, right? There is joy that just comes out of him. Bishop Tutu, Archbishop Tutu, was exactly the same. It was all about this joy that flowed out of them, even in the midst of the sheer grit and determination with which they lived their lives in this very hard world. The Dalai Lama is quoted as saying, "From the moment of our birth, every human being wants to discover happiness and avoid suffering. From the very core of our being, we simply desire joy and contentment. Outward attainment does not bring joy. We must look inside to find it." So for all three characters in my sermon today, Desmond Tutu, Dalai Lama, and the woman who found the coin, the pillar of joy on the inside changed how they lived going forward in the difficult worlds they inhabited. And so, as we face this war-torn, roller coaster world of ours, it helps us to articulate the inner pillars of our heart, those things that hold us up and which never run dry. Because that is where the birth of new possibilities will arise. And that we call resurrection. Now, a story. I was a minister in Aurora, Ontario, some 20 years ago now, and encountered a parishioner there by the name of Evelyn Wilkinson. If some of her kids see this video, I hope that they'll understand that I'm quoting her with abandon and with joy. She was a charge nurse. She was at the top of her game, very successful in that world. A straight talker, she could bend the will of doctors with any kind of word that she had. She always got what she wanted, which of course was what was best for the patient. But she was a heavy smoker, and she knew that it was a problem. And wouldn't you know, Evelyn got lung cancer, and it was far too gone before anybody could do anything about it. She was really upfront about it. She said she knew it was killing her, yet she continued to do it anyway. But something inside of her changed. Something inside of her was transformed. She would go on these big baking binges, invite people in for tea, feed them to over full, and then send all the leftovers home with them. Every day, she would call up people that she thought were lonely or sick, facing their own surgery of some kind, maybe, and she would pray with them on the phone. She was uber kind to me for some reason, not quite sure why. She wanted to know who I was, what made me tick, and then once she got to know me, she said, "Now this is what I want you to say about me at my funeral." Which I did. Underneath all of this was a profound spirit of joy. She claimed that she'd had it all along, but that somehow, excuse me, almost at the end, and I have to do this. She claimed that she had this joy in her all along, that she knew that she had it there. But that receiving a terminal diagnosis just made her want to share more of it with others, and she claimed she was going to do that until the very last breath. And I do believe that she did that. She prayed about everything. She prayed out loud to God all day long. She said she wanted to make sure that God heard her prayers. She cried endless tears as well, out loud too, for the exact same reason. She wanted God to hear her tears. You see, Evelyn would not let cancer define her, right? She would not let the default world tell her who she was, right? That she was a bad person, that she didn't quit smoking when she knew she should have, that she was a cancer patient, right? That she was a victim of her own choices. She said, "I know all of that." But she said, "I want to be known as a person of joy, as a person of love, and as a person of great spirit." And I would say, to use the metaphor, that in her final few months, Evelyn walked inside the kingdom of heaven, through the pillars of joy, which held up the structure and meaning of her life. It was wonderful to be a part of it. As I think about it, even now, I realize that she was creating a structure for the rest of us to walk inside as well. And so, my friends, this is what life is all about, right? It is about creating a structure of meaning and hope for your life, and then inviting others whom you love into it, and sharing the lessons that you have learned that have helped you create those pillars that hold up your life. It is an alternative way of thinking about yourself. It's not the default world. It's an alternative world. In contrast to the world of pain and suffering, we can find joy, love, compassion, and equanimity in every single moment. And that's what I think the lesson of the woman and the coin has for us today. Amen. was great. Thank you very much. Now let us pray. Holy God, we thank you for this day and for all its astounding beauty, its fullness, and the opportunities it brings us. As we contemplate the day ahead of us, may we be aware of your divine presence in every moment, in every situation, whether good or bad, joyful or painful. May we always remember that your presence is with us, that it lives inside us, that your desire is to be known to us and to dwell within us. God, help us to bring to mind the many things which bring us joy. May we remember those who offer generosity and kindness to us. May we remember to be kind and generous in our own actions and in our words. May we always be grateful for the many small wonders that make our lives meaningful and full of blessing. Today, O God, let me open the cavern of my heart and discover there the pillars of love, joy, compassion, and equanimity. Help me to remember that these gifts never run out. I can empty myself over and over and yet still find more. Help me to be open to the offerings of others. Help me to not hold back when someone needs from me. Help me pay attention to those worries that rest on my heart. And as I contemplate the people I might interact with today, help me to wonder about the message that I will give them or that I need to hear from them. Help me to ask, what do I need to change, or who do I need to forgive? Help me to keep my heart in an open flow, for I know that I dwell always in your heart, O God. Holy One, thank you for this day, for all its lessons, all its grace, and all its opportunities. May we find strength for tomorrow and love enough for today. And now we bring our hearts and minds into the words Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Amazing grace.
I want more.
Friends, let us leave this place in joy. Let us be led forth in the peace of Christ. Let the mountains and hills break forth in song. Let our hearts and minds carry a song of joy to the world. And until we meet again, may joy hold you and keep you and bring you home. Amen. Amen.